Chapter 7 Outline, The Labor Market. 7-1, A Tour of the Labor Market. 7-2, Movements in Unemployment. 7-3, Wage Determination. 7-4, Price Determination. 7-5, The Natural Rate of Unemployment. 7-6, Where We Go From Here. The Labor Market. We have focused on the short run by assuming a constant price level in the ISLM model. We now turn to the medium run and explore how prices and wages adjust over time and how this in turn affects output. The labor market is the center of that sequence of events. 7-1, A Tour of the Labor Market. Figure 7-1 shows population, labor force, employment, and unemployment in the United States in millions for the year 2014. The unemployment rate is the ratio of the unemployed to the labor force times 100. It was 9.5 over 155.9 times 100 equal to 6.1% in 2014. Total population was 318.9 million. Non-institutional civilian population was 247.9 million. Non-institutional civilian population refers to the people over 16 who are not in the armed forces or behind bars or in mental institutions who are potentially available for civilian employment. Civilian labor force was 155.9 million. Civilian labor force equals people employed plus people unemployed. People who are employed full-time or part-time are considered employed. People who are not working but have looked for work in the past 4 weeks are considered unemployed. Those who are not looking for work are considered out of the labor force. Labor force participation rate, LFPR, is the ratio of the labor force to the non-institutional civilian population. Non-employment rate equals non-institutional civilian population minus number employed and the difference divided by the non-institutional civilian population. Figure 7-2 shows average monthly flows between employment, unemployment, and non-participation in the United States 1996 to 2014, millions. To understand what a certain unemployment rate means for individual workers, we must look at the movement of workers. On average, each month, a large number of workers moves in and out of employment, unemployment, and into and out of the labor force. For example, on average, out of 8.8 million unemployed, about 3.9 million left the ranks of the unemployed, 2 million found jobs, and 1.9 million dropped out of the labor force. The duration of unemployment in this case is 2 to 3 months. This reflects the fact that unemployment on average lasts a short time. However, in times when the unemployment rate is higher, the average duration of unemployment increases. The unemployment rate may understate the true extent of unemployment because discouraged workers who have stopped looking for work are not counted as unemployed. Many who are classified as out of the labor force are in fact discouraged workers, not actively looking for a job, but will take it if they find one. So rather than the unemployment rate, economists sometimes focus on the employment rate, the ratio of employment to the population available to work. A given unemployment rate may reflect either an active labor market, many separations and hires, that is, many workers entering and exiting unemployment, or a sclerotic labor market, few separations and hires, and a stagnant unemployment pool. The current population survey, CPS, shows the average monthly flows. Separations include quits and layoffs. The average duration of unemployment, the length of time people spend unemployed, is 2 to 3 months. Focus, the current population survey. The current population survey is the main source of the Labor Department's statistics on labor force, employment, participations, and earnings in the United States. It is based on about 60,000 households interviewed each month. Economists use these data to get snapshots of the economy at various points in time and how the same people do in two consecutive months. 7-2, movements in unemployment. Figure 7-2 shows movements in the United States unemployment rate from 1948 to 2014. Notice two important features. One, unemployment rates seem to be on an upward trend from 1950s to the mid-1980s and then on a downward trend till 2006. Two, year-to-year fluctuations are closely associated with recessions and expansions. Two of the highest unemployment rates in the recent past reached in 1982 and 2009-10. Figure 7-4 shows the unemployment rate and the proportion of unemployed finding jobs 1996 to 2014. You can see how fluctuations in the aggregate unemployment rate affect individual workers. When the unemployment rate is high, percentage of unemployed workers finding a job each month falls. Note that the scale on the right is an inverse scale. Figure 7-5 shows the unemployment rate and the monthly separation rate from employment, 1996 to 2014. Note, when unemployment is higher, a higher proportion of workers lose their jobs. 7-2, movements in unemployment, summing up. When unemployment is high, workers are worse off in two ways. Employed workers face a higher probability of losing their job. Unemployed workers face a lower probability of finding a job, or they can expect to remain unemployed for a longer time. 7-3, wage determination. Sometimes wages are set by collective bargaining, a bargaining between unions and firms. Slightly more than 10% of US workers' wages are set by collective bargaining. The higher the skills needed to do the job, the more likely there is to be bargaining between employers and individual employees. Collective bargaining plays an important role in Japan and most European countries. 7-3, wage determination. Workers are typically paid a wage exceeding their reservation wage, the wage that would make them indifferent between working or being unemployed. Wages typically depend on labor market conditions. The lower the unemployment rate, the higher the wages. Workers' bargaining power depends on how costly it is for the firm to find other workers, how hard it is for workers to find another job if they were to leave the firm. Efficiency wage theories link the productivity or the efficiency of workers to the wage they are paid. Firms may want to pay a wage above the reservation wage in order to decrease workers' turnover and increase productivity. Firms that see employee morale and commitment as essential to the quality of workers' work will pay more than those whose activities are routine. When unemployment is low, firms that want to avoid an increase in quits will increase wages to induce workers to stay with the firms. Focus: Henry Ford and efficiency wages. Table 1 shows annual turnover and layoff rates in percent at Ford 1913 to 1915. In 1914, Henry Ford, the builder of Model T, announced that his company would pay all qualified employees a minimum of $5 a day for an 8-hour day, compared to previously an average of $2.30 for a 9-hour day. The turnover rate plunged from 370% in 1913 to 16% in 1915. The layoff rate collapsed from 62% to nearly 0%. 7-3, wage determination. Two theories of wage determination are that 1, wages are set by collective bargaining, and 2, companies may pay efficiency wages above the reservation wage, the wage at which a worker is indifferent between working or being unemployed. Bargaining power depends on labor market conditions denoted by the unemployment rate U and other institutional and structural factors Z. Equation 7.1 says nominal wages W depend on the expected price level PE, unemployment rate U, and the catch-all variable Z. A doubling of the expected price level will lead to a doubling of wages. The minus sign under U indicates that an increase in unemployment rate will decrease wages. The plus sign under Z indicates that an increase in unemployment benefits or minimum wage will increase wages. Both workers and firms care about real wages, W over P, not nominal wages. The nominal wage depends on the expected price level rather than the actual price level, because when nominal wages are set, the relevant price levels are not yet known. An increase in the unemployment rate decreases wages. Higher unemployment either weakens workers' bargaining power or allows firms to pay lower wages and still keep workers willing to work. Z stands for all the factors that affect wages given the expected price level and the unemployment rate. For example, unemployment insurance as the payment of unemployment benefits to workers who lose their jobs. Employment protection makes it more expensive for firms to lay off workers. 7-4, price determination. The prices set by firms depend on their costs, which in turn depends on the nature of the production function Y equals AN, where Y is output, N is employment, and A is labor productivity, output per worker, assuming labor is the only input being used to produce output and one worker produces one unit of output. The production function is the relationship between the inputs used in production and the quantity of output produced and on the prices of these inputs. Equation 7.2 assumes a very simple form of the production function, Y equals N, by putting A equals 1. So we are assuming that the cost of producing one more unit of output is the cost of one more worker equal W. Assume imperfect competition in the goods market, so firms have some pricing power. Then they set prices according to equation 7.3, where price is equal to a markup M over cost. P equals 1 plus M times W. 7-5, the natural rate of unemployment. Let us now look at the implications of wage and price determination on unemployment in the medium run. Assume P equals PE, which is true in the medium run. Then real wage implied by wage setting relation is shown by equation 7.4. It shows that higher unemployment will lead to lower real wage being chosen by wage setters. Now let us find the real wage implied by the price setting relation given by equation 7.3 earlier. After dividing both sides of the relation by W and inverting, real wage implied by the price setting relation is given by equation 7.6 that says W over P equals 1 over 1 plus M. It implies a decrease in real wage when the markup increases. Figure 7-6 shows wage setting relation, price setting relation, and the natural rate of unemployment. Wage setting relation is negatively sloped when real wage is plotted against unemployment rate. The higher the unemployment rate, lower is the real wage. Price setting relation plots as a horizontal curve because real wage, as implied by price setting relation, does not depend on the unemployment rate. It depends on the markup. Natural rate of unemployment is given by the point where the two curves intersect. This shows equilibrium in the labor market because the real wage chosen by the wage setters is equal to the real wage implied by the price setting relation. The natural rate of unemployment is the unemployment rate such that the real wage chosen in wage setting is equal to the real wage implied by price setting. Notice the natural rate of unemployment will change when either of the two curves shifts due to a change in Z or M. The equilibrium unemployment rate UN can be derived by eliminating W over P between equation 7.4 and 7.6. Equation 7.7 shows that UN depends on Z and M. UN is also called the natural rate of unemployment or the structural rate of unemployment. Figure 7-7 shows the impact of an increase in unemployment benefits on the natural rate of unemployment. An increase in unemployment benefits leads to an increase in the natural rate of unemployment. Increase in unemployment benefit Z shifts the weight setting curve upward. The curve shifts from WS to WS prime. Equilibrium moves from point A to A prime. Equilibrium unemployment rate increases from UN to UN prime. Figure 7-8 shows the impact of an increase in markup on the natural rate of unemployment. An increase in the markup leads to an increase in the natural rate of unemployment. Increase in markup M shifts the price setting relation down from BS to PS prime. Equilibrium moves from point A to A prime along the given weight setting curve. Equilibrium unemployment increases from UN to UN prime. 7-6, where we go from here. We have assumed that the price level is equal to the expected price level. In the short run, the price level may well turn out to be different from what is expected when nominal wages are set, so that unemployment is not necessarily equal to the natural rate or output equal to its natural level. Because expectations are unlikely to be systematically wrong, in the medium run, output tends to return to its natural level. The next chapter will relax the assumption that the price level is equal to the expected price level.